Hello and welcome to the next session on Behaviour Modification Model of Learning Implementation in the Classroom. In the previous lesson, we discussed classical conditioning and operant conditioning and how these are the simplest theories that had impact on later theories. According to behaviorism, behavior is an action that is observable, and learning is acquisition of new behavior through conditioning. We know that all behavior is learned, and therefore behavior can also be unlearned. All behavior is directed by stimuli or environment. A behavior is likely to be repeated when it is reinforced. A reinforced behavior leads to habit formation, and behavior is less likely to be repeated, gets extinguished. In day-to-day life, we see examples of these behavior. Your parents may have conditioned you to the fact that if a black cat crosses your path when you're going out, then something adverse will happen. So you keep thinking about that incident every time during the day if something that you desired did not happen. And there is also another conditioning where you go out in the dark and you keep looking back on your shoulder because you have been conditioned to think that going out in the dark is dangerous.
Yeah, right. I think what you are saying is very true in the two, as you quickly summarized what we discussed in the last lesson, that we get conditioned, and we get conditioned by various ways. Definitely in real life, whether it is in our regular day-to-day life or whether it is in classroom learning, these conditionings play a strong role. So today we will look at negative reinforcement, which we discussed in our earlier lesson, how we are going to make use of negative reinforcement, the various processes of conditioning and consequences that can be made use of in the under negative reinforcement. In part two, we are going to focus negative reinforcement in the classroom context. To give a generic example, what happens in negative reinforcement? A response is strengthened by removal of something that is considered unpleasant, right?
Yes.
So if something that is unpleasant, which could be headache, in this case let's take it, then we take an aspirin and we find that the headache vanishes, right? So what happens? Every time the person gets a headache, the person will go back to taking an aspirin because the consequence is very, very positive. That means the unpleasant feeling of having a headache is removed.
Hmm.
Correct. So in a classroom, how can we make use of this negative reinforcement, where we will be removing an unpleasant consequence every time the child or every time the student demonstrates a behavior which is the desired behavior or desired outcome? How can we work on that?
In this situation, sometimes there are some students who disruptive behaviors.
Right.
They keep calling out to their fellow classmates, or they keep calling out to the teacher. The teacher wants to stop this behavior.
Mm-hmm.
So first the teacher ignores it.
Mm-hmm.
But if the child continues with it, then the teacher gives out a punishment that either he will lose some points in the grade, or he will be asked to stand outside the class, or he will not be given a recess, he will not be asked to go out and play. These are some kind of negative reinforcement that the teacher will employ.
Okay. So when we are talking about negative reinforcement, we are actually talking about removal of an unpleasant consequence, right? So if, for example, the behavior that we are looking at, a modification, the unpleasant consequence that we, let us start from the other way around, top instead of, you know, bottom to top approach. We are looking at an unpleasant consequence that could be that I do not get into an MBA, right? If that is the unpleasant consequence, and the unpleasant consequence is the result of my not studying, right? So if I demonstrate the behavior of studying regularly, repetitively, then that unpleasant consequence is removed. This is called negative reinforcement, right? So the same thing can be applied in the classroom. also when it comes to either when it comes to language learning or when it comes to learning of any other subject that we can bring into the classroom. That's something called negative reinforcement, which can be used in the classroom very, very effectively to modify the behavior, to build a new skill, to bring in new knowledge, and also at times it can be used for value system, right?
Yes.
Yeah. The next thing that we need to keep in mind and see how it can be made use of in the classroom is punishment model. Punishment, which is another kind of conditioning, operant conditioning, that is very, very useful. So, what is punishment basically all about? An action or a behavior, right, that leads to an adverse outcome.
Yes.
Isn't it? So, if a particular behavior is demonstrated, then it leads to an adverse or a negative or a not so happy outcome. Isn't that what the whole thing is about? Punishment is all about. So, it is basically called, again there are two kinds of punishment. One is called positive and one is called negative
punishment.
So, what happens is actually, to give a very, very simple example. So, example, I am playing with fire, let us say. So, this is a behavior that it needs to be weakened. What is the consequence of playing with fire? I burn my fingers. Or for example, a child is playing with blade. I am taking a generic example to start with. And is not careful about using a sharp instrument, the blade. So, the child cuts the finger and there is blood, right? So, I want, what is it the desire, what is it that the teacher desires? The teacher desires to weaken this behavior. This behavior needs to be removed. And therefore, the fear of cutting the finger or the fear of burning the hand is the punishment. That is positive punishment, right? So, what is actually being done? An unfavorable outcome or event is shown to the learner to weaken that particular response. So, for example, not so much advocate of this particular model, but for example, if a child is learning language, let us say, and every time the child learns, is using a wrong pronunciation, let's say, for example, in a phonetics class, and is learning a new language and uses wrong pronunciation. So, every time the child uses a wrong pronunciation, the child loses the impact of that could also be that the classroom starts laughing, the other kids start laughing, right?
Yeah, or this teacher could give an imposition where the learner has to repeat it so many times that
weaken this. So, how does a teacher weaken this particular usage or pattern is by giving, as you said, the imposition to repeat it multiple times. Mm-hmm. The child will then start, or the learner will start pronouncing it correctly to avoid that adverse consequence, right? Let us look at what is negative punishment.
So, a favorable event or outcome is removed after the behavior occurs.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
So, if the child does not listen to the parents, he is given a timeout,
mm-hmm,
and asked to miss his favorite TV program.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So, in the class, child may not be given the tokens, or the tokens that were already given to him are withdrawn,
mm-hmm,
or some the child is asked to give back some of the tokens.
Yeah. So, I mean, to take a generic example could be like largely teenagers. So, they like to spend a lot of time with their friends. So, if there is a misdemeanor or a misbehavior that the child has demonstrated or the teenager has demonstrated, then what do? We curtail that particular privilege. And the child is grounded, or the teenager is grounded. To take it into the classroom situation and to how do we make use of this for learning. Let us say there is an event, upcoming event. Let us say there is a skit that is going to happen, and we have a student who likes to act, and the skit, and we are using this to develop, let us say, English language proficiency. If you are using that, then what do we do? If the child or the learner does not make use of correct pronunciation or does not make use of accurate or correct English language usage, then what do? We do not, the child or the student does not get an opportunity to act, right? So, if this kind of privilege is continued or is shown as a pattern, then the child will start working to become a better user of the language and speaking fluently. We are talking about reinforcement, and there is a pattern that one needs to look at. Obviously, if you have a classroom of 60 students, then every time the 60 students make a mistake, you cannot individually give reinforcement. Sometimes it's not possible, right? Or one cannot, you know, make this continuous reinforcement a practice in a day-to-day classroom or a teaching condition or a situation. So, what do we do? There are different models or schedules that are kept in mind. So, what are these schedules that we are looking at?
One is a continuous schedule, the other one is partial or intermittent. In continuous schedule, the reinforcement is given every single time the behavior occurs.
Okay.
But in a intermittent or partial schedule, the reinforcement occurs only part of the time.
Right.
And the continuous schedule, learning takes place in quickly or instantly, whereas in a partial schedule, the learning is acquired more slowly. So it is advised that we start with, when the learner starts learning a new concept or a behavior, the reinforcement should be continuous.
Right.
But after some time, when the learner has to maintain that behavior, then the reinforcement can be partial.
Absolutely. For example, let's say we are talking about learning a new language. Let's say I'm trying to learn Spanish or I want to learn French. Under those situations, and especially when we are thinking of the learner picking up the language very, very quickly in a short window of learning, that is where I think the continuous reinforcement schedule works very well.
Yes.
Right. But when we are looking at moving it into a much larger, you know, spanned out, that is, let's say, secondary, tertiary level of learning, where we want to use language in a much more complex, in multiple occasions, right? And then if that is, and use it consistently, right?
Yes.
So the behavior needs to be repeated consistently in various situations and needs to become part of the system. It could even be a skill, right? A particular skill. The skill of, let us say, being able to solve mathematical problems through a period of 6 months or through a period of 1 year, and then making that part of the system, you know, that intensive learning. There, I feel that the partial reinforcement schedule works really well. Or for example, we are looking at a value system that we want to inculcate in the learner. We are looking at doing scientific experiments, right, where multiple times the experiment needs to be done in a following a particular procedure, and then there is a, you know, result, or there is a reinforcer that is given, where I feel that the partial reinforcement schedule works. And especially if you are looking at a reinforcement schedule which is negative, or we are looking at a reinforcement schedule which is moved into the punishment level, then I feel that maybe getting into the partial model works well for the learners. However, there is this four principles that we need to keep in mind when we are talking about conditioning, and very, very important that this works out really well in the classroom context. One of those is principle of immediacy. As teachers, we are the closest with our learners when we are looking at a learning environment, isn't it? So, in principles of immediacy, if we are looking at teacher behavior that or instructor behavior that brings the student much closer, right? Much closer to the learning model, much closer to the instructor also, so that you know the learning is faster. Some of the behaviors that we need to look at, that we need to really demonstrate in the classroom as teachers, and they can be of two categories, right? What about the non-verbal ones, Usha?
Non-verbal ones such as smiling, mm-hmm. or moving around the class and patting on the shoulder.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
These are some of the non-verbal reinforcements.
Mm.
And for some learners, a smile may be just enough.
Mm. Mm.
But some learners require that they be verbally praised in front of the class, or they feel that they should be called to the front of the class and asked, they should explain some concept.
Right, right. Mm.
So this gives them a positive boost to learn more effectively.
Right, right. So here basically we are saying that the principle of immediacy works to bring the instructor and the student closer. So when they come closer, the learning is much more impactful. Learning is also higher, right? And the learning curve is faster. I mean, very, very steep.
Yes.
It happens pretty quickly. And it can be at two levels. It can be at the non-verbal and the verbal level. Let's look at the next principle, which is called the principle of deprivation or satiation, right? So the principle of deprivation talks about, not having access to something that is highly desirable, very much like, you know, just to bring in the what we were talking about reinforcers or what we were talking about in the punishment conditioning, right? Mm. So deprivation. So if I am continuously deprived of something that I really want, earlier in schools, we would get promoted, right, if we demonstrate a particular kind of behavior change. In this case, acquisition of certain knowledges, demonstration of certain skills, and continuous practice or continuous use of certain value system or behavior, isn't it? So if this is deprived, so if a student is deprived from what is called promotion or being promoted to the next class, that could be one principle of deprivation. Of course, it's a very high consequence example that I have given. These could be at very, very small levels, right? The other could be the opposite of deprivation. It is having too much.
Too much. So,
yeah.
In this case, I would like to give an example where the teacher wants to inculcate the habit of reading in the classroom.
Right.
And for every book that the learners read, the teacher gives them some kind of a star or a token.
Mm.
And in the end, they can exchange these for something that they want.
Okay.
But in case a learner is already has that, suppose the teacher wants to reward them with a new book, if they have collected 10 tokens, and the learner already has that book with him, or the learner has already read that book, then he won't work further to read different books.
This is very interesting, isn't it? The satiation principle that we are talking about, where I think the child gets bored with
yes,
too much.
Too much, yes.
So that I think for teachers, as teachers for us, what is very important is that we rework on the novelty of what we are providing as a reward to the child.
Yes.
Or the consequence that the child, the impact of doing something, demonstrating a desirable behavior or doing something that is really desired by the teacher, the consequence needs to be varied. Mm-hmm. It needs to be interesting. It can be multiple. It can also therefore be a varied, a partial, schedule of reinforcer, isn't it? So if I get too much of the same thing too many times, then I lose interest in doing them because the reward is not challenging enough, not interesting enough for me. let's look at what is the third principle that we are looking at vis-a-vis conditioning, and that's called the principle of contingency. What is happening? Like, for example, if I do very well in the first 10 years of my education, right, there is something available for me at the end of it. This is called principle of contingency, actually.
I will get admission into a good college, mm-hmm, or a good university.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Or if I have a dream, my dream is to get into a particular profession. It could be, you know, to get into journalism. It could be getting into becoming what is largely seen as mainstream profession of, you know, becoming an engineer or a doctor. Or it could be doing something out of the box. And that's my aim. So, the teacher is able to show very clearly, predict with certainty, for me that I really want to work for it. That's basically what is the meaning of principle of size, right? And all these can be used in the classroom to motivate learners, to move learners from level A to level B, to show them that that movement has much larger consequence. So with this, we just touch upon observational learning. We have already introduced Bandura about observational learning and his observational learning. So, Usha, would you like to talk a little more about that?
As I said, children, when they are infants, they usually try to imitate adult behavior.
Mm-hmm.
So, in the classroom also, if the behavior is positive and the student tries to imitate it, it will lead to better and effective learning.
Mm-hmm. Which is true. So, in other words, it is also called social learning, because these are social behaviors, actions that we see in others, and we observe it and then we put it as part of our lifestyle or our learning. And that especially happens in the classroom context. So, for teachers, it's very important that they model a behavior that they want their learners to demonstrate, learn, and then or model a skill, demonstrate that skill in real life. You know, like they say, walk the talk. So, it's not enough for me to say you need to speak correctly while I am myself speaking incorrectly, right? Or for example, I say that I keep telling students that they need to improve in particular subjects or they need to build certain skills. It could be the skill of extempore speaking or public speaking. It could be the skill of speaking fluently. It could be a skill, let's say we are teaching creative writing, and I stand there as a teacher of creative writing and I am spouting all the rules of creative writing, but I am not able to demonstrate it. So, I am not able to write it creatively and show it to my students, then obviously students don't have that kind of, trust in me,
yeah,
right? They don't think that I am modeling the behavior. Yes. So, whatever I say, I should be able to model as a teacher, as a coach in fact, this really works very, very well when we are talking about classroom learning situation. So, with this we close today's session. Thank you very much. Thank you.